I once wrote a book that's called The Language of the Genes, and it's a fairly obvious parallel between language, the transmission of information through words, and the transmission of information through DNA. And DNA is a kind of language. What it is, it's a series of instructions which tell the cells of the body what to do. Now, if you learn a language, you cannot speak it unless you know and understand the grammar. So it's all very well and good having the words, but unless you know the way these are put together, you can't speak the language. And evolution is the grammar of biology. Charles Darwin, who came up with the theory of evolution in 1859, in The Origin of Species, he actually more or less invented biology as a science. Before him, there were plenty of people doing good biological research. For example, finding new fossils, discovering new kinds of plants and animals, looking at the migration of birds, breeding better plants and breeding better crops, breeding better farm animals. All these people were doing biology, and they were all doing the same thing, but they didn't realize they were doing the same thing. Once The Origin of Species came out, suddenly everything fell into place. So if I'm teaching biology now, I'm teaching evolution now, I can take examples from plants, from humans, from bacteria, and just weave them together into a single narrative. And that's what evolution does. And it's very strange to me that so many people across the world are determined to deny the fact of evolution. They somehow think that it drags them down to the level of the animals, or in my view, it does exactly the opposite. We do so many things which are unique to us we set ourselves apart from the animal kingdom. But many people have a quite false idea about what evolution actually is. They see it as a kind of faith or a doctrine, but it's not. It's only a science. And you can summarize what evolution is in Darwin's phrase, and he called it descent with modification. Descent, the passage of information from one generation to the next, and modification, the fact that that passage is imperfect, that there are mistakes, okay? There are errors or mutations, as we call them now. Now, we can rephrase Darwin's three words today. Evolution is genetics plus time. If you've got genetics, DNA, genes, all that stuff, and you've got time, and we know now we have hundreds of or thousands of millions of years since the origin of life, and if you've got mistakes, mutations, and they happen all the time, then evolution is bound to happen. Nothing magical about it at all. It's got to happen. It's like taking a photocopy of a photocopy of a photocopy. Mistakes are made every time, and so the image changes. But then Darwin came up with the central part of that mechanism, which is what he called natural selection. And one of the standard complaints about evolution, how it can't be true, is that how could a simple mechanism, a biological mechanism, design or produce something like the human eye, which is fantastically complicated? And many people say you can't have design without a designer. But natural selection does exactly that. Natural selection is a series of successful mistakes. There are mutations, there are errors, and some of those mutations actually increase the chance that those who inherit them will survive and will reproduce and pass on the genes. So that natural selection consists simply of inherited differences in reproductive success. It's a two-part exam. You need to do two things. You have to stay alive. And of course, most people now stay alive in the developed world until they're old enough to reproduce. And then you have to find a mate and have children. And and there are differences among people and among fruit flies and among dogs in the ability to do that. And that's natural selection. And very quickly, you can generate these amazingly complicated objects like the human eye or the human knee or the bacterial cell wall by this simple mechanism. So that's what evolution is. The question is, what kinds of evidence are there for evolution? And Darwin wrote his book, The Origin of Species, in a great rush because he got a letter from the Far East from Alfred Russel Wallace, who independently had the same idea. And Darwin had been thinking about evolution for 30 years, and he'd never really put anything on paper. And he got this letter in 1857, which completely shattered him. He said, all my originality has been smashed. And he immediately sat down and started writing The Origin of Species. Okay. And he called it what the sketch. And this building here, the Darwin Building, is on the site of Darwin's house in London. Okay, so we feel really very close to Charles Darwin. He called his book a sketch. And if you've read it, which I have many times, it's, you know, it's 127,000 words long. It's not exactly a sketch. But he wrote it in less than a year. With a pen, not with a word processor. And he, in the beginning, he says, this book is one long argument. And it's very, very clever in laying out the evidence for evolution. It starts off with something which is completely familiar, farming. And the first chapter is called Variation Under Domestication. And he points out that if you go to a farm, you will find some cattle that produce beef, some cattle that produce milk. You find and so on for plants. Some plants produce seeds, some plants produce big tubers. And yet they're obviously related to wild animals like wild cattle or grasses for the plants, which don't do this at all. So why should this be? Well, obviously, farmers in the past have been choosing, selecting the cows that produce most milk or the wheats that produce most seeds. And if you do that long enough, you'll have change. You'll have evolution, okay? And that's obvious. Everyone can see that. Then the next chapter is called Variation Under Nature. In other words, this could happen in the wild as well. And he talks about examples where that might happen. And of course, now in the modern world, we have hundreds of them. Some of them are very familiar, like the evolution of resistance to drugs by bacteria. To antibiotics. Bacteria have evolved by natural selection resistance to almost all known antibiotics. There's only one left now, really, and that too would probably become useless in the next 10 years. And that's Darwin's mechanism happening in front of your eyes. And then he goes on through the various points. He has a lot about fossils, and of course he really knew very little about fossils, but he has a lot about them. He has a lot about geography and about islands in particular. And famously, Charles Darwin visited the Galapagos Islands in the Pacific. And it didn't form his ideas at all, really. He only spent 5 weeks of his five-week journey around the world on the Galapagos. And he collected what are now called the birds, which are now called Darwin's finches. He collected them, but he didn't take any notice of them. He just jumbled them all together. But one thing he did notice, which really set the idea of change in his mind, was if you looked at the plants and the animals of the Galapagos Islands, which are a couple of hundred kilometers out in the ocean from South America, and they're volcanoes, the Galapagos, which have come up from the bottom of the sea, they were remarkably similar to the animals and plants in South America. But before getting to the Galapagos, Darwin had come south from Britain and had visited in the Atlantic the Cape Verde Islands. And the Cape Verde Islands, they too are volcanic islands out in the ocean about 300 or 400 kilometers from the African coast. And if you show a picture of the Cape Verde Islands and the Galapagos Islands, they look almost exactly the same. But the Cape Verde Islands animals and plants were like those on Africa, not like those on the Galapagos. And of course, in those days, before evolution, many people believed that God or something had created plants and animals to fit the environments in which they live. Now, because the Cape Verdes and the Galapagos are so similar, if it was a creator or some magical scheme, you would expect the plants and animals on those two islands to be the same. But they're not. They're similar to, but different from, their nearest mainlands. So that gave Darwin the idea of change. And once you have the idea of change, then suddenly you need to have a mechanism. And at the very end of his book, The Origin of Species, two pages from the end, all right, he dares to say, light will be cast upon man and his origins. And that's what really scared people, the idea that humans had emerged from this apparently simple mechanism. Well, it may scare them, but it's true. Okay, it's clearly true. The evidence for human evolution is now overwhelming. And it's in fact obvious. Queen Victoria went to London Zoo in the 1830s, before The Origin was published. And she was a highly intelligent woman, and she wrote in her diary, she visited the orangutan, his name was Jenny. And she writes in her diary that the orangutan is painfully and obviously human in appearance. And so she could see the similarity, which is obvious, between apes and ourselves, but she couldn't believe that it was there, because of course she believed in creationism, as did many people. But later in her life, she actually used to read The Origin of Species to her children in bed, and I'm sure that sent them to sleep straight away. So that's the history of evolution. And now, of course, it's in a new phase, because now we're in a situation where we can study the evolution and change of anything we like with modern technology. And this has answered many, many problems. It's shown absolutely directly that we are, of course, closely related to chimpanzees. The fossils and the genes combined to tell us that our common ancestor with chimpanzees existed only about 7 million years ago, which in evolutionary terms is yesterday. Okay, it tells us that there's much more variation than we ever thought. It tells us that there are large numbers of genes, not as many as we expected. There are only about 23,000 genes that go to make a human being. And to put that into context of human complexity, and we are complex creatures, there are about the same number of genes that go to make a human being as there are of parts in a London Transport double-decker bus. There are 23,000 parts in a double-decker bus, and there are 20,000 to 3,000 genes that go to make humans. But what that tells us is we don't understand the way the genes are put together, so we have a lot more to learn, and evolution will tell us much more about it. Most important, perhaps, evolution is beginning to tell us something about the origin of species, and that, strangely, is the one question which is not really approached in Darwin's book. Darwin's book is called On the Origin of Species by the Preservation of Favoured Races in the Struggle for Life. That's its full title. But when you look at it, there's very little about the origin of species in it. And the reason is you can't do genetics with different species. You can't take cats and dogs and cross them together to see what comes out, because nothing comes out. Because species in some ways are like republics. There are republics, each one is a republic of genes. Sometimes a bit of leakage between two adjacent species, but not very much. But with modern technology, we can look at the genes in different species, and we can see which ones are involved in making species distinct. So really, as always happens in science, new technology has answered lots of evolutionary questions, but it's posed an awful lot more.